In this tutorial, we'll be going over how to make a simple frag grenade, complete with throwing logic, some pretty simple physics, and the ability to damage enemies and interact with the environment. Hope you enjoy. Let's start by creating a new scene. In other node, we'll set a rigid body node as our parent. This will be our grenade scene. Next, I'm going to add a model as a child of our rigid body. For this tutorial, I'll be using a model that I made in Blender. Remember, you can also use a mesh instance or your own model. Great, now let's add a collision shape node to our rigid body so that it will collide with other objects. In the shape menu, we'll select sphere shape, then move this to fit closely around our grenade. Nice, now we have a simple grenade scene. We'll set up our physics later. For now, let's start implementing our throwing logic. In our player scene, which has already been set up with a camera, mesh, etc., we're going to start by adding a marker node to the neck of our player. The neck is basically just the point of rotation for our camera. Wherever our neck rotates, our marker will follow. This will be where our grenade is spawned from. For the sake of simplicity, I'm going to have our grenade spawn from the center of our camera. Might look a little silly, but it'll get the job done. Okay, let's move on to coding. With our nodes set up, let's go into our player script. Here we'll start creating our throwing code. First, we'll set up a variable that preloads our grenade scene, which I'll call grenade. Remember to use the grenade.gd file. Next, in our physics process function, we'll create another function, which I'll call grenade throw. This is where we're going to set up our throwing logic. Now, let's close off this code block and create our grenade throw function. In here, I'm first going to create an if statement to check if our throwing input action is released. But wait a minute, we still need to set up our input buttons. In project settings, click on the input map menu. In here, I'm going to add a new action, which I'll call throw. Now, using the plus icon, we can add an input for our action. For my project, I'll use the left mouse button. Now, back in our grenade throw function, we're going to check if our throw button is released once. After the statement, we'll create a variable that will instantiate our grenade scene. Remember to set this equal to our preload variable. Next, we're going to set our grenade spawn position equal to our marker node's global position. Remember that we renamed our marker node grenade boss. Finally, we'll add our grenade as a child of the current scene. With that done, let's move on to creating our throwing logic. First, I'm going to create a variable that will control the strength of our force. I'll name this force. Remember that this will have to be negative so that our grenade will move away from the player. Next, we're going to create a variable that will control the arch of our grenade. I'll call this our upward direction. Now, we'll create a variable that captures our player's rotation. First, we'll use global transform.basis.z to find the forward rotation of our neck. Then, we'll normalize our rotation so it stays consistent, regardless of where we're facing. Finally, we're going to attach an apply central impulse method to our grenade variable, which applies a single central impulse to our body. In here, we're going to pass in our player rotation variable. Next, we'll multiply this by our force, then, we'll add our force variable to a vector 3, which will hold our upward direction on the y-axis. Doing this will ensure that our force will be applied in the same direction that our player is facing, and that it will always travel in an arc. Great, now that we have our throwing logic taken care of, the final thing I want to add is a limit to how fast we can throw our grenades. For, well, obvious reasons. To do this, we'll first need to add a timer node to our player. I'll call this our throw timer. In here, I'm going to set the wait time, then, we'll want to select one shot so that our timer emits only once. In the node menu, we're going to add a timeout signal to our script. Next, let's first create a canthrowBoolean variable, which will determine when we can throw our grenade. This will be true by default. Now, in our timeout function, we'll want to set our canthrow variable to true here as well. Great, now in our grenade throw function, after we push our throw button, we'll also want to check if our canthrow variable is true. Then, we'll set canthrow to false, so we can't throw, and finally, we'll start our throw timer. Great, now, when we run our scene and push our throw button, we'll be able to throw our grenade. Although, they seem to have some pretty weird and inconsistent behavior. Let's move on to implementing some simple physics. Usually in games, there are many things that influence the behavior of grenades, such as weight, size, velocity, etc. Thankfully, in Godot, much of our physics can be handled using rigid bodies. Remember that the behavior of your grenade will depend on your specific project, so feel free to experiment with what I'm about to show you. In the physics material drop-down menu, we'll add a new physics material. In here, I'm going to set our bounciness to be 0.4. Great, with that, our grenades will be able to bounce after interacting with other objects. Next, in the solver drop-down menu, make sure the continuous collision detection is turned on. This will ensure that we have accurate, precise collisions and that our grenade will not clip through other objects. Nice, with that, our grenade's physics are pretty much taken care of. Pretty simple, right? Now, if we run the scene, our grenades will collide with and bounce off other objects. For a bit more realistic movement, I added this bit of code that applies linear and angular dampening to our grenades after they collide with other objects too. Before we start setting up our grenade logic, we're first going to code a simple enemy. As you can see, I've already set up an enemy scene with a character body, mesh, and collision shape. Assuming that you've already done this as well, let's start by adding a group to our enemy. In the node menu, click on group, then add a group name. For this project, I'm going to name our group enemy. Now, after adding a script to our enemy, we can start coding basic damage logic. First, we're going to create a health variable, which I'll set to 25. Next, we're going to create a simple function, called enemyHit. In these parentheses, we'll want to pass in a damage variable. I know this doesn't make sense now, but remember this function, as we'll use it later on. In here, we'll first want our health to go down by the amount in our damage variable. Now, we'll want to check if the enemy's health is less than or equal to 0. If it is, we'll want to delete the enemy from the scene. Great, now we can start actually adding some functionality to our grenade. In our grenade scene, we'll first want to add an Area 3D node to our scene, with a collision shape node as its child. Let's make this a sphere shape. Now, we'll need to resize this to be at least twice the size of our grenade model. This will represent the blast radius of our grenade. With this setup, we'll want to add a timer as a child of our rigid body, which will basically represent the fuse delay of our grenade. In here, I'm going to set the wait time to be 5 seconds. We'll also want to select auto start. Now, in our node menu, we're going to want to add a timeout signal to our grenade script. This is where we'll set up our explosion logic. First, let's set up a damage variable, which I'll set to deal 50 damage. Now, in our timeout function, let's create another variable, which I'll call bodies, which will return any bodies that are overlapping with our radius. Now, we're going to create a for loop that will check for any objects in our body variable. Next, we'll want to make an if statement to check if the object is in the enemy group. Now, when both of these checks are true, we'll attach our enemy hit method to our object. Remember that we'll need to pass in our damage variable as well. Hopefully now you can see the connection between the enemy hit function and the enemy and grenade scripts. Basically, if there are any objects in the grenade's radius, the enemy hit function will be called and damage will be dealt. Finally, we're going to delete our grenade by calling qfree. Great, after we instance our grenade, and the timer is called, the grenade will explode, causing enemies in its radius to die. But there's one small issue here. Even enemies behind cover will get damaged too. To demonstrate how we can fix this, I made this little model. Fixing this issue is actually quite simple. Basically, once our grenade explodes, we'll want to shoot a raycast at any enemy in its radius. If the line of sight between the raycast and the enemy remains unbroken, the enemy will die, while any enemy behind cover will remain unharmed. Let's start by creating a variable, called params. Here, we'll call a class called physicsRayQueryParameters3D, and attach a create method. Now, we're going to cast a ray from our grenade's position, to the position of any other object, by using globalTransform.origin to find its origin point. Next, we'll create another variable, called result, which will return our world scene and create our raycast. We'll want to pass in our params variable here, which will tell our intersect ray function where our raycast will be created. Now, in the final if statement, we're going to check if the results collider is in the enemy group. Finally, when we meet each of these conditions, we'll call our enemy hit method. Alright, now after instancing our grenade, and once the timer is called, the grenade will explode, only dealing damage to the enemies within direct line of sight of our raycasts. This isn't the only way of using groups to add functionality to our grenades. For example, if we wanted our grenades to interact a bit more with the environment, like blowing up these boxes, we can start by creating a box scene, which consists of a rigid body, mesh instance, and collision shape. We'll also want to add a group name to our box as well. Now, back in our grenade script, we'll first want to create an if statement that checks if an object is in the box group. Then, we'll want to create a variable that finds the current location of our grenade. Finally, we'll want to attach a box hit method to our object and pass in our source variable. Now that our grenades can detect our boxes, let's get working on box physics. In our box script, we'll want to create a variable that contains our force. Then, let's add our box hit function that we created in our grenade script. Finally, in an apply central force method, we'll want to subtract the current position of our box by the source position of our grenade. We'll then want to normalize this and multiply it by our force, which will determine how far our boxes will fly when hit. Now our grenades can apply force to other rigid bodies and send them flying. Great, after combining everything we've worked on and adding a bit of juice to our game, I think our grenade comes together pretty nicely, although I didn't add everything I'd liked. I hope you found this tutorial helpful. Also, I'll be leaving some other resources that I found useful in the description. Feel free to check those out. Have a good day, see you in the next video.